My guest at this time can be seen every week as part of MLW. It is EJ Nduka, the judge in the house. EJ, thank you so much for taking the time to chat with me here today.
Thank you for having me, Nick.
Oh, man. It's been a little... I chatted with you shortly after you had wrapped up with WWE. It's been a minute here now. Mm-hmm. You're with MLW. Before we get into what all you're doing with MLW, we got a chance to really see you in the ring for the first time. Battle Riot coming out. Who is EJ the Judge Nduka? What do you think people should know about you now that you are off the chain, I guess?
The judge is the equalizer. The judge is as advertised. You know, I let you guys know that when I come, I plan to show up and shout out. And that's exactly what I did.
Yeah, 100%. Most eliminations ever at Battle Riot 3.
Correct. 12. Not one, not two, but 12.
So how did this feel, EJ, to be able to come out, be on TV, wrestling in front of fans? What was that moment like for you at Battle Riot, EJ?
It was like my jubilee. It was amazing. For the last 2 years, I had been working. I'd been the first one at the PC, the last one to leave. I'd been working on myself, working on my character, working on everything to be a star. And I got an opportunity to showcase that in MLW, my very first match on TV, in a way that it was amazing. It happened. The guys are awesome. You know, I learned a lot. I was able to put what my strength are with is my power, my speed and agility onto a match, and then show my character, who I am, the equalizer.
Yeah. Was there anybody in the Battle Riot that you in particular enjoyed, like getting to spend a moment or two with wrestling there in the ring? Was there somebody you were happy you got to lock up with there in that match?
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's so many guys. I mean, Alex Kane is a star. Davey Richards, he's awesome. All those guys, you know, even chopping it up with them backstage. King Mo had a lot of nuggets. You know, he's been with MLW for a minute now. And, you know, he kind of just gave me some of the things to expect. And everybody just had positive things to say about MLW. There was no negativity. There was no complaint, nothing like that. It was just a family atmosphere, and everybody just, you know, came to show up and show out.
So that was kind of one of the things I wanted to ask you about. So, like, how different is the MLW backstage vibe for you? You're very much a WWE product. Like, yeah. How is it adapting to non-WWE life and being in a different kind of space?
I can only speak on, I've been in the Raw and SmackDown locker room a handful of times, but I've been in NXT locker room. For the most part, NXT locker room was dope. When I was there, Priest, Cole, and some of those guys, they were the locker room leaders, and they're approachable guys. They're cool guys, you know. So it's not that much of a difference as far as the locker room. As far as, like, the production and how things are produced, you have a lot more autonomy and creativity in MLW. You have a lot of things that you can do. You can bounce off ideas off of other people. And you don't have to worry about, you know, being told no. Maybe it's not yes right then, but there's another avenue. Maybe we can get it to it a different way, if that makes sense. It's never like, no, that's not a good idea. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure. Who I know you mentioned King Mo there. Are there other brains and minds backstage MLW in particular that you were excited to kind of sit under that learning tree and spend a couple minutes talking with them, or no?
There's a ton of guys. I mean, you know, the Riot had like 40 people. So just being able to go back and talk to people about different spots, different things I want to get to, what are you good at? And, you know, just putting it together to make some magic. I mean, I'm telling you, everybody back there are phenomenal athletes. I mean, these guys, they're professionals and they're good at what they do. So, I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, everyone back there, I learned from.
Cool. Well, before I take a step forward, I'll take a step back, I guess, real quick. You know, you were a really hot free agent no more. I would imagine that you were fielding a couple offers before kind of settling on MLW. Like, what exactly about MLW was offered to you or appealed to you that made you feel like this is the place I need to make the next step for me right now?
To be 100% transparent, it was the transparency of Court and the guys over there just being honest with me, you know, just letting me know, like, you're in a unique position in your career. You are a star. You are going to be a star, but you haven't been given the opportunity to showcase that. And it's funny, I haven't even shared this with Court or any other guys, but when I was getting recruited to go to play college football, there was a lot of big D1 schools that came around and, you know, were interested, but I ended up signing with Sam Houston. Back then, in 2007, Sam Houston wasn't the Sam Houston everybody knows now, the FCS national champion. They were a 500 program, barely 500 program. They barely won. But what I fell in love with was the opportunity to come and build and grow with someone that believed in me as much as I believed in myself. And I felt that from Court when I talked to him, and I felt that from Joseph when I spoke to him, and it meshed to like the plans that I had and what I expected out of myself. They believe that I can achieve that. And it was just match made in heaven.
Dude, that's awesome, man. I love that comparison there. Cause like, this isn't your first time being recruited. You know, I think of you out there as this free agent, having just kind of been in WWE world, but you're used to be as a high caliber athlete. You're used to being recruited and people coming around and throwing offers in your face.
Yeah. I was recruited in college. And then when I played pro, you know, you go through free agency as well. And, you know, that's your opportunity to find a team that fits best with you. And not everybody fits best with all programs. Every program is different. And it's the same thing in this world, you know, and sometimes, you know, being able to talk to some of the guys in the back and some of the talent and, you know, people backstage, you kind of get a feel for that organization. And I know I've said it before, but I'm yet to hear anything negative about MLW. They do a phenomenal job of, you know, listening to the fans, what they want. They do a phenomenal job listening to the athletes, the talent backstage. And we come together and we put on a show, and Fightland is going to be a show.
Yeah, so let's talk about Fightland here. A couple of cool things going on at Fightland. First of all, this thing is going to go down October 2nd back at the 2300 Arena, but it's going to get to be shown on national television, Vice TV, coming out of Dark Side of the Ring the Thursday after on October 7th. What does that feel like to you to know that, you know, MLW is making this move and that you're going to be making this move with them to starting to do these TV specials?
And this is what I'm saying, major moves from major places. You know, MLW is coming right after Dark Side of the Ring. So just think about the demographic of people that are going to go from watching that to now being maybe exposed to MLW for the first time. It's going to be a unique opportunity and an amazing opportunity all in the same breath.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it's. I hope it's like an upper, right? I hope it's like, you know, because you know, I think a lot of people at the end of last week's Dark Side of the Ring were kind of, you know, not in a great mood.
Right. You know, it's funny. I'm yet to watch it. I just talked to some of the boys about it, and I'm like, damn, don't tell me. I haven't watched it yet because I've been so busy with my son. But I'm actually going to watch it after this.
Okay, cool. Well, you know, it's a watch for sure. Yeah. So enjoy. But yeah, that's a big time slot there right after Dark Side. Nice, beautiful lead in there.
Nice segue.
You guys are going to be doing some really cool stuff at Fightland. You won the Battle Riot. I don't see you listed here yet for the Opera Cup. You know, it's all about Fatu. What are your plans here for Fightland, EJ?
My plan is to continue this momentum going. If anybody wants to see me, this is an open challenge right now. If anybody wants to see me in that square circle, the judge is ready, you know? And I think that Fightland, because we're going to be on Vice TV, this will be a great opportunity to show the world the caliber athletes we got backstage, me being one of them.
Yeah, Tajiri will be there. I know I saw you on Twitter comment about how he has merchandise. You have merchandise. Like, possible. Would you like salivate a little bit at the idea of maybe stepping in the ring with Tajiri at some point?
Oh, no question. Yes, that would definitely be an awesome opportunity.
Yeah, for sure. So on the show here, too, the big main event, right? Like, I'm sure whoever walks out of this thing is going to be in your crosshair, so to speak. Oh,
I mean, they both on my crosshairs right now. You know, the judge is always watching. You better believe. Okay. It doesn't matter what match it is. I'm watching. I'm spectating. I'm always taking notes.
So Alexander Hammerstone, national openweight champion, taking on world heavyweight champion Jacob Fatu. One of these men is going to walk out as dual champion. Who do you Who do you think it'll be? Who do you have your money on here, EJ?
I have my money on whoever wants it more. Okay. And I guess we'll find out October 2nd. I'm going to go and I'm going to look at him in the eyes. I'm going to find out, because the eyes is a gateway to the soul. And I'm going to find out who wants it more. Because at the end of the day, whoever's back is down after that three count, you didn't want it as much as my man over here.
That's not really an answer to my question. I get it. Chicken soup for the pro wrestling soul. I understand.
Yeah.
But no, you don't want to, like, is there one of them that you'd rather walk out so that you could go after them in their co-championship? Is there a preferred matchup of Fatu or Hammerstone for you?
I mean, you know, the judge doesn't write down names of who he wants to dominate. You know what I mean? So it doesn't matter. Whoever wants more, I want it more than you. So it's going to come down to who wants it more.
Okay, great. All right. Well, enough of these questions, because this is going nowhere fast right now. I was surprised to see you not in the Opera Cup, man. Or maybe, I mean, there's still a spot open, I guess, in the Opera Cup, but I was surprised to see you not in that mix. I thought you were a layup for this year.
You and me, bro. I don't know. It's full right now. I think Alex Shelley took the last spot.
Oh, that's right. Shelley took the last spot.
Yeah, Alex Shelley took the last spot. But, you know, I think that would have been a great opportunity to show the world that I'm capable, I'm versatile, and that I can work in that ring. I mean, I did show it in the Battle Riot, but, you know, you can never stop.
That's why I was like, yeah, coming off the Battle Riot. I was like, I thought it made sense anyway. Court, I'm sure, has the method to, you know, the mayhem here or whatever. Mm-hmm. But one of the names I thought was interesting was Bobby Fish. Now, he's somebody just like yourself, fresh out of WWE. What do you think about Bobby Fish joining MLW, competing in the Opera Cup here?
I think that's great. Like I said, MLW is doing a good job of getting some of these free agents that are in the pool. Bobby Fish fits right in with what's going on here. The fighting style, the mixing the MMA and his wrestling is it'll be interesting to watch. I'm going to be watching his match.
Well, and like with Bobby, he was, you know, obviously in an Undisputed Era, which had Adam Cole, Kyle O'Reilly, and Roderick Strong. Do you feel like Bobby Fish got the same kind of opportunities or chances in NXT that maybe he should have or not? Like, I don't know.
Undisputed moved as a unit. So we always saw them as one. They were, you know, the brotherhood. Fish did get hurt. So that might have derailed a lot of the plans that they had for him. I don't know much about it. I don't know what creative or whatever they were doing backstage, but from my eyes, I always saw Undisputed as a unit, and they moved well as a unit.
So what about units, right? There's like a couple units floating around MLW. Do you want to stay a lone wolf in MLW? Would you like to move as a pack? Like, what do you see yourself doing for it?
The judge is a lone mercenary, but, you know, I am here to avenge. I'm not one to revenge, but I do avenge, if that makes sense. So, you know, I don't mind standing next toe to toe with someone who sees eye to eye and, you know, sees the way that I see things and helping out here and there. But for the most part, you know, the judge is a man of alone.
Well, somebody else I thought was interesting in the Opera Cup this year, Lee Moriarty is going to be in the Opera Cup. He also just signed with AEW. That's pretty cool. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot of like playing back and forth with different promotions, including MLW. Mm-hmm. Do you see that forbidden door being open for you? Or are you focused on MLW? Would you like to kind of maybe get to play around in those waters? What do you think about that situation?
Oh, yeah, no question. Without a doubt, if that door opens, the boy, I'm walking through it. Legs full speed. And any opportunity that presents itself, you know, if it's something that is, I guess you guys would quote the forbidden door, why not? I mean, it's only going to help everybody. At this point, I don't see the benefit of being extremely exclusive, because it just gets more eyes on the matches, more eyes on each promotion, and it gives more opportunities.
Yeah, what are you and kind of MLW kind of has like its own kind of, I guess, a forbidden door. I mean, it seems like there's going to be another bit of content coming out, Azteca Lucha. I don't know what you think about that project and if you have any interest in maybe doing something fun over in those waters as well.
Yeah. You guys know where to find me, Aztec Lucha. If you want the boy, I'm right here. The judges as advertised. But well, that's
you might die though. Like there's like monsters that eat people and there's
fire. I don't die. The trash is that's die anytime soon.
EJ, I want to thank you so much for taking some time to chat with me. And I'm really happy that you found a good landing pad there over at MLW. Very excited to see you at Fightland, and congratulations again on Battle Riot. Is there anything you want to plug, promote, put over here before we wrap up the interview?
Absolutely, guys. Hey, I want to thank you for having me here. You guys check out the merch. I don't know if you can see it. The merch is always on my page. My Instagram is at EJ underscore. My Twitter is EJ the Judge. There's a new line of stuff that just came out. Make sure you're drippy and looking good. October 7th, Fightland is going to be on Vice TV. Make sure you guys are tuned in.